You know what I hate? Buying things. Why have money lying around when you could gamble your financial future? Good evening, I'm Bagabuns, and if that sounds like you, then look no further than crowdfunding, where you could turn your dreams into reality, or alternatively, witness them being crushed by a stampede of cunning frauds. What is crowdfunding, you ask? Well, crowdfunding is when a crowd funds something.
Congratulations, you are so smart, cool, and funny.
In 1997, fans of a British rock band called Marillion came online to scrape together $60,000 to get them to tour in America. Well, why can't somebody pay me to be in America? This place sucks. This was the first instance of crowdfunding the way we see it today. Going online to support some ambition that could possibly change the world. It's probably not going to because it's not Choo Choo Rocket, but let a guy dream. Am I right, fellas, or am I right, fellas? There technically were other types of crowdfunding projects before the Marillion one, but nobody really wants to hear about some litigation crowdfunding thing that went on in the 18th century. Ugh, it's so boring. While it had kind of been around in many shapes and sizes, the internet made it so much easier for nerds like you and me to gather together and pour money into a project that we want to see happen, usually created by indie artists who think they have great ideas. Like Zach's Potato Salad. This is the world before Zach's Potato Salad. And this is the world after Zach's Potato Salad. When you think about crowdfunding nowadays, you hear about websites like GoFundMe, Indiegogo, and today's subject, Kickstarter. Kickstarter is great. It's nice and vibrant, and it has a fairly healthy community in every single one of its categories. But the category I want to focus on today is video games. If you're new here, hi, this is my channel niche. But aside from that, video games have an interesting relationship with Kickstarter, being one of their most popular and most funded, but also sometimes most abstract project categories. Lots of good projects come out of it, like Hollow Knight, Shantae Half Genie Hero, Bloodstained Ritual of the Night, Undertale. I could go on for ages. But for every good project, you have the stinkers. Ukulele, maybe Shenmue 3. I still don't know how I feel about Shenmue 3. What I'm saying is that crowdfunding is a risk. Your money is going to an idea rather than a product. And sometimes ideas don't really work. So sites like Kickstarter supposedly make it relatively painless to get your money back if a project doesn't come to fruition. But for some reason, projects get rolled out over years or sometimes are just flat out ignored. There are many more projects that lied about what they are or have no intention of ever giving their backers their promised rewards. And Kickstarter seems completely cool with that. This video talks about the main issues of these Kickstarter campaigns that will leave their backers angry, sometimes to the point of legal action. Before we start, drop a sub on the channel for some free quality content. There's zero risk, and you'll be a satisfied customer. Wanna see something not cool? Mighty Number 9 is the punching bag of video games in general. It started off with a really cool premise, and every other sneak peek we got of the game was pretty ugly.
Know you like that combo on combo action, and make the bad guys cry like an anime fan on prom night.
Well, who crawled into your panties? This game raised a truckload of money, but there's no telling if this $4 million went to development or what. It just seemed mismanaged, and the mismanagement carried over into the timeliness of the rewards that Mighty Number 9 promised its backers. Many of the consoles Mighty Number 9 was slated to release on were discontinued. So if you own a Wii, I'm going to make fun of you. But also, I'm so sorry you didn't get Mighty Number 9. Nah, I'm still gonna make fun of you. But people also backed it on 3DS, which I think the game would have looked noticeably less ugly on. But that never worked out. It would have been cool if they offered a game code for another platform instead of, you know, ghosting them. That's the issue with video game Kickstarters in particular. They would ideally have to make their promise and release their game within the 7-year time window of a console's lifespan. Otherwise, what do you do if you can't release the game on a platform you promised? I want to be fair to all the developers involved in the projects I'm covering. They slave over this because they want to make something cool. So I don't think they should necessarily be held accountable for not physically being able to deliver that version of the game, but they should be held accountable for what people laid their hard-earned money down to support. People are not getting games, they are not getting merchandise, and if you promise the reward to get people hooked on your idea, you should be held to your word. Maybe you heard of this little game called Omori. It's a fantastic Earthbound-like experience with a unique style and art direction done by the director, Omocat. It started off as a webcomic series that she drew, but then expanded into a game and RPG maker. Even though Omocat had no prior game development experience, no pixel art experience, and a pretty small team, the game turned out pretty swell. It has good characters, good art, good world building, good story, good mental health portrayal. Those are all things good games sometimes have. You could tell, based on all these super positive reviews, that it's beloved by everybody. Except the people who helped them raise over $200,000. Omocat, did you like forget how to send emails or something? It's a war in the comments. One of Omori's backing goals is a free digital game on the platform of their choice, which is offered if they pledge $15 or more. The issue is that the folks in Europe and Japan who backed Omori never received their Nintendo Switch codes for the game, and the developers at Omocat were radio silent. They still released updates, but they are completely deaf to the criticism. There are waves of negative comments and no responses or updates to defuse the angry mob. Omocat had the same issue of not responding to the people back in 2015 and 2016 when the project was still in development and missing its deadline. But back then, it was because they didn't want to spoil anything about the game. Now that it's out and Omocat still remains silent, it just kinda seems like they're blowing them off. Even if the team is working on getting it out, maybe communicate to your backers in any way possible. Just let the people know they're being heard, how you're doing, anything like that. You can argue that Kickstarter is not a store and you take a risk when backing a project, and you'd be right. Unless that project meets its funding goal, which Omori obliterated by over 900%. Some people haven't gotten art books, some have been sent keys that straight up don't work. And since Omori's original stretch goal was for 3DS instead of Switch, the people who pledge for the 3DS version don't know what to do. Section 4 of Kickstarter's own terms of use says that Omocat must fulfill each reward. It's in bold. So how is it that some of the people who made Omori possible still have yet to even touch it? It's a wildly successful game, but you never be able to guess that because of how much of a mess the campaign was. It's as simple as letting your fans know you heard their concerns and telling them what you're gonna do about it. Over the few years that I've been alive, I've learned a valuable lesson. Don't bite off more than you could chew unless you have a really deep throat. This is not from personal experience or anything, since I do not have a mouth. But I also don't have 60,000 people waiting for me to release a video game. Do you all remember Friday Night Funkin'? A demo version of the game sort of blew up in 2021 and was hyped up for a full release on Kickstarter, where it raised over $2 million. The issue with that is that typically, as a project receives more and more funding, the project creators tease juicy rewards that can be unlocked after a certain dollar goal is hit. This typically gets fans to donate more money to see cool things in a cool project. But if you're too ambitious, then the fans will get a little bit irritated. Let's look at the rewards that are promised in Friday Night Funkin'. There are plenty of promises that are made here, like stretching out the length of the game with additional weeks, adding a whole nother difficulty mode, more animation work, more playable characters, more new music, and online multiplayer. That's so much stuff! And on top of that, they have to fulfill the rewards for individual backers, like the 5 people who get a custom playable character, the 50 people who got a personalized illustration, and the thousands of people who requested physical merchandise. The team behind it doesn't look too big at the moment, so they're putting in a lot of hours to get the stuff done. We can see plenty of fans starting to get irritated about the slow progress of development. But behind the scenes, I think we can be confident that the game will turn out alright. People have been getting what they've been backing, for the most part, and they post regular updates on their website. They've also been hiring people to help develop the game, so it should speed up. It's gearing up to be a really good project, but it just had to jump over some pretty big hurdles with some pretty limited resources. On the other hand, we have Dream World. Where do I even start? The tagline? The last game you'll ever play. What, are you gonna kill me after this? This game is not very popular among its backers. Although for some reason, some people on the Dreamworld YouTube comment section seem to have a change of heart about this project. And I could definitely commend the indie developers for pushing through the backlash and even coming out with the game at all. But come on, they clearly have no clue what the hell they're doing. I've stalked their LinkedIn profiles, and they're both very smart and hardworking people with a passion for the game that they're making, but no sense for game design whatsoever. They started on such a large scale with so few resources that their backers are going to get a below average experience. If you look at their trailers and listen to all their promises, you'll realize that all this stuff isn't ambition, it's a lack of direction. That's not me being mean, that's a fact. They're trying to make a full-on open-world MMORPG with a very small and inexperienced team, and not that much money. If you didn't know, MMORPGs are very expensive to produce and maintain. Oh wow, $50 million. That's pretty close to $65,000, right? And while Unity and Unreal Engine allow you to make these types of games for a much nicer price tag, you're probably going to be stuck with a lot of stock assets and stuff. That's exactly what these guys did. An experienced game dev would use these character models as placeholders. Unoriginal code, a dumpster fire combo of ideas, gross, mismatched stock visuals. This game looks like a mess, and the backers just seem to stop caring altogether. It's a dead comment section. And it doesn't help that all the developer responses are copied and pasted corporate nothingness, and that they use child labor to moderate their Discord server. Yikes. There's a lot more to uncover, but I'll link a more comprehensive video by Callum Upton, somebody more experienced in this matter than I am. The point is, both of these games have promised more than they were able to realistically do, and the developers could either delay the game indefinitely like Friday Night Funkin', or release a disaster like Dreamworld. And that's just a game. This doesn't even mention that the reward tiers are probably going to be delayed indefinitely as well. Nobody wins in this scenario. The backers will lose interest in the game, and the developers are being crushed under a mountain of expectation that they brought upon themselves. Kickstarter's terms of service should be the law by which all project creators and backers should abide by if they want to use Kickstarter. Unfortunately, Kickstarter seems to choose to ignore certain things on their terms of service and enforce others. For example, they don't truly enforce the collection of backer rewards. That's why Omori and Mighty No. 9 could go silent for years while some of their fans remain empty-handed. I can sort of get the fact that these teams need some time to roll out these projects, but there's a certain point of no return where the developers just don't ever intend on giving backers what they funded. To be honest, there is no one perfect solution to this issue. We don't know if they misuse their funds or aren't able to physically produce their product or anything like that. So it'd be tough to make every creator refund their backers or face repercussions if something goes wrong. And I don't really think Kickstarter would be very motivated to make developers give back what they funded. This is just speculation, but Kickstarter makes 5% off funds that projects receive. So if a project is fully funded, Kickstarter usually gets paid. If Kickstarter forces the projects to refund their users, they also have to give up whatever they made to the backers as well. So usually, if there's an issue, it's taken off Kickstarter and handled in a lawsuit or something. Also, Kickstarter has this label titled Project We Love, which usually draws people into these projects because it's probably a safe bet, right? Unfortunately, this label seems to have very little to do with the quality of the company or the product, and a lot to do with the attention it gets. Do you guys really love Mighty No. 9, or do you like the fact that you get a cut of that $3 million? Because I can assure you that even the backers don't love this game. The label is seemingly given out at random, but you can't tell me that there aren't ways to artificially obtain it, so we could sort of see a power imbalance at play here. Kickstarter pushes projects that have the budget to advertise, and as a result, they trample over smaller projects. And we still see these fraudulent products with the label on, because Kickstarter doesn't like taking them down for the sake of transparency or something. You know what would be more transparent? Maybe not associating this label with Kickstarter's most expensive failures? I know that this is all hindsight and they can't know which projects are going to be trustworthy at that stage, but the fact that Kickstarter still leaves the label on multi-million dollar delusions like Chronicles of Illyria makes it seem like they don't care, which is even worse. What is a project Kickstarter loves anymore? A multi-million dollar waste of space run by a company that doesn't know what it's doing apparently. Projects should take accountability. I agree. But too many high-profile projects are very much exploiting the generosity of its terms of use. Now when many people think about Kickstarter, people think about the projects that make them go, "Ah, crap! I can't believe I put my money towards that thing." I'm not being fair. Kickstarter is a great site that gives us great stuff, so how about I show you that stuff instead? Alright, now let's talk about a project that I backed, which I believe to be the gold standard of Kickstarter projects. Mina the Hollower is an example of a Kickstarter campaign done right. And not only because the studio raised like $1 million on the project, congratulations. Yacht Club Games were developers of multiple highly successful and innovative projects, most of them having Shovel Knight in the title. The point still stands. Right out the gate, their Kickstarter page is full of personality and professionalism. They leave regular updates to check in on how things are going. And I cannot stress enough that these updates are regular updates. Not, "Oh, I'm gonna post for 2 months and then disappear off the face of the earth until the deadline." Yeah, I know. It should be a given that you get a little bit of news every now and then about how something you invested in is going along. And I think people can be pretty understanding if you need to take more time or take a break if it means that the developers are working on the project at 100%. Anyways, within Mina the Hollower's updates, you can often find things like developer commentaries, sprite art, music streams, and all that sort of stuff. But every now and then, they like to get a little bit wild. Art contests, speedrunning races, Twitch challenges, all sorts of stuff. They even added in extra stuff that weren't in the stretch goals. Yacht Club Games wants to engage you in this world of Mina the Hollower, and their backers are treated like VIPs. It's kind of like a demo before the game releases, only, you know, less corporate and a million times more exciting. And get this, Yacht Club Games even responded to my lame joke that I posted in the comments. That puts a massive smile on my face. In the updates, they run live streams and host competitions, and they're clearly passionate about the games they create, and they love interacting with their community. This isn't just a Kickstarter campaign, this is like a full-blown event, and I somehow wiggled my way into it with 20 bucks, which, as a broke person, I'm more than happy to part with. I came out of this experience with a much higher level of love and respect for Yacht Club Games, but unfortunately, not every company is as epic as them. Which is when Kickstarter passion projects turn into Kickstarter scams. But, to be completely fair, I can't place all the blame on the poor planning of the developers, even when they don't produce a completely trustworthy product. I'm looking at you. That's right, you. The potential backer. Don't just throw money away. Here are a bunch of rules to follow before dumping your savings into something. 1. Check the history of the devs. Not everybody has a critically acclaimed game under their belt like Yacht Club, but you could at least find the history of whoever's managing the project. Find their company or team, check out the leads, the designers, programmers, or whoever. Maybe their LinkedIn or social media. Are they experienced in what they need to be? Wow, nice GPA. Too bad engineering school and game design aren't the same thing. Check out the way they interact with the community as well. A transparent and trusting relationship between the company and its audience is always good. And maybe you're wondering, well, what if I can't find the project manager? Well, then don't give them a single penny. I'm dead serious. Why would you hand money to somebody you don't know anything about? That's a red flag. That's bad. Don't do that. 2. Read the risks. There is a section dedicated to project risks. Hey, you should really take a look at that. Maybe it's important. So, all I gotta do is look for a project that says they have zero risks, right? No, of course not. If the project had no risk involved, then why do they even need money? There will be issues regarding budgeting, distribution, delays, and all that. A lot of that is outside of the artist or game dev's control. So saying that there are no risks in funding their project is arrogant and irresponsible. Even a noble such as Zach Danger Brown himself admits that his potato salad might not be that good, even though it puts Gordon Ramsay's entire career to shame. While we do like an honest creator, if they got too many issues, then obviously don't put your money towards that either. Finally, and most importantly, 3. Don't be stupid. I don't know. Like, why would you fund something that looks like this? Why would you ever donate this unholy sum of money? Is what you're funding even a good idea at all? Is Zach's potato salad even a good idea? His backers had trouble getting a hold of their funding goals as well. It's just so hard to trust people nowadays. I'm gonna go play Mina the Hollower now. Thanks for watching. Good night, everybody. Thank you.